Welcome back. We are going to, this is our third video on refrigeration cycles. We are going to study the actual vapor compression cycle, in which we are going to introduce some changes between the ideal that we described in our last video with respect to the actual. The actual refrigeration cycle, we are going to start by saying that we the first thing that we will have is our pressure drop. Pressure drop will create a slant in the line. Instead of being a straight line, an isothermal line, will have a slant that will decrease in the direction of the flow, because that direction of the flow will show also the delta P. Remember that the condition for a fluid to flow is to have a pressure difference. So the pressure reduces in the direction of the flow. That should help you to understand the how you need to slant this line. Could not be this way, the way I'm showing in the video, because if we do it in this direction, that would mean that we are flowing against some pressure, and that's impossible. So this will be the condenser. The evaporator will have the same thing. We're gonna have some pressure drop that will decrease in the direction of the flow. So that's one of the things that will change from our ideal to an actual vapor compression. Second is that we don't have an isentropic compression. If we have just some friction and heat exchange, we could have two changes. Typically, we are going to have an increase in entropy. And that will be expressed with this slanted line to the right of the system, of the diagram. But sometimes could be to the left. How can this be? How can we compress a gas and decrease its entropy? Well, if we have some cooling, then we could overcome the changes and the increase in entropy by cooling the whole compression and the whole compressor, and that way we will have this line. But most typically we'll have line like this. Third, we have some superheat and some subcooling, and there are practical reasons for that. Let's go back to the diagram. Let's say that at the entrance of the exit evaporator, we don't have 100% vapor. We have some drops of liquid. When these drops of liquid arrive to the compressor, especially to the compression valves, they will change very rapidly, something similar to this, to the cavitation, will damage our valve by putting them to thermal stresses. Our compressor member cannot compress two phases. So a way of ensuring that we have some 100% vapor to this compressor is by allowing the fluid, the refrigerant, to superheat a couple of degrees. If we superheat more than a couple of degrees, then we are using a lot of space in our evaporator to absorb small amount of heat. Remember that change of phase is a very efficient process to absorb heat in a small, with a small space or mass, but once we have vapor, that vapor occupies a lot of space and absorbs real heat. Same can happen, the same can be done with the condenser. We can, once that we have saturated liquid, we would like to do the expansion valve. But if we have bubbles of vapor, I mean, if we still have some vapor, we will occupy a lot of space in that valve, reducing its efficiency. So we would like to have 100% liquid, and a way of doing that would be supercooling it. That is cooling below the saturation temperature, while superheating is heating above the saturation temperature. Let's introduce another thing, and we're gonna call this the approach. We discussed this in class, and I'm gonna use a blue color. So I'm gonna draw we're gonna define approach here. And in order to do that, I'm going to talk about evaporator now. So in the evaporator, I have, let me change this color so it's not that hot. Let's start with an orange one. We have the temperature. The low temperature reservoir. You know what? Let's change this to blue. We have the temperature of our low temperature reservoir. And let's say this is minus 15. Okay. Sorry about that. And we would like to have our freezer or evaporator below this temperature. And let me just draw differently. This is my heat exchanger, right? So, because of this temperature difference, I will have S heat. We already described this, but we're gonna define a new temperature difference, and this temperature difference will be the approach. It's the temperature difference between the outlet of the evaporator and the cold medium. Okay? So this could be just the temperature of the evaporator outlet. Sorry, the other way. The temperature of the low temperature medium reservoir minus the temperature of the evaporator outlet. Typically, we have 10 to 50 degrees Fahrenheit. That will be 10 or 8 degrees Celsius, and this is required because we will need to have some temperature difference in order to have still have this heat flowing. We're gonna define a second delta T that we just talked about, and I will delta T superheat. This is typically 2 degrees Celsius. Well, here's typically about 8 to 10 degrees Celsius. So at the end, So then we could have we can get this evaporation temperature with respect to this temperature, and we can draw this line just to amplify. We have diagram of temperature with respect of the length of the evaporator, and just use the same colors. We know this is temperature L. We have our evaporator. We will have, and please recognize that we are having a pressure drop, and then at some point we're going to have a superheat. So this difference is my superheat, while this difference here is the approach. So if we, I would like to have the evaporator, I will say that the temperature in the evaporator will be TL minus the approach. That is the difference that I have to maintain between the evaporator and the cold temperature reservoir, minus the superheat. I have to draw this right so you can understand it. Okay. We can draw exactly the same for the condenser. In the condenser, this will be different. I will use another color just to make sure. We have the condenser. And then we have the high temperature reservoir. So we have some heat, right? And we're gonna have again an approach. This approach will be delta T of the condenser. That's the temperature that I need to maintain between the high temperature reservoir and the exit of that condenser. And I will have a second delta T. And this delta T will be between the exit and the saturation. So this delta T will be the subcooling. So at the end, if I would like to have the temperature, the condensation temperature will be TH plus the approach plus the degree of subcooling. I'm going to repeat this diagram here will look a little bit different. This is the condenser, the temperature, and this is the length of the heat exchanger. And I will draw TH . This TH is typical the ambient, so it will not change. And then we have our condensed temperature. Remember that in state 2 we start as a superheated vapor. So we start here and then we go down until we get to saturation. And then we subcool. So this line will be the condensing temperature. This difference . This will be my subcooling, and this difference is approach. It's not to scale, it's just to simplify, and you can recognize the direction of the heat interactions going QL. QH. One last thing that we should talk about is about the volumetric efficiency. And for the volumetric efficiency, we should recognize that the effect of leakage, pressure drop across the intake exhaust valves, the clearance volumes, and other inefficiency reduce the suction volumetric flow rate relative to displacement rate. The displacement rate is what we count, the amount of gas that we are displacing, and yet that will be a very good measure of the capacity, because the greater the displacement rate, the mass, the greater the mass flow rate that we can pump into our system. So if we define the volumetric efficiency as volumetric flow rate at the suction divided by the volumetric flow rate, the displacement, and you can recognize that this volumetric flow rate, the displacement, is a function of the diameter, the stroke, and the speed, and will be in cubic meter per second. And the mass, the volumetric at the suction could be as a mass flow rate times the specific volume at the inlet of the compressor. We can substitute and say that the volumetric will be the mass flow rate times the specific volume at the inlet of the compressor divided by the displacement. And you can recognize that this displacement is similar to what we have in the Otto cycle. So if we solve for the mass flow rate will be the volumetric efficiency times the volumetric flow rate of displacement divided by the specific volume at the inlet. This specific volume is just the inverse of the density. Because of this, if we compute the capacity versus the evaporation temperature, we will have a curve like this, and we're going to do it in one example. Okay, so finally, in order to finish with the actual, we just need to go back here and remember the sources of what will make an actual cycle be the non-isentropic compression, and we didn't express that, but that isentropic efficiency will be defined similar to what we defined earlier, H2S minus H1, H actual minus H2 actual. Minus H1. Any of these conditions will make the cycle actual. So you can see that we can have a different combination. Well, you can see one of these videos in order to see them what makes our cycle actual opposite to the video one. Thank you very much.